Okay, I don't even know how to start this. Well, I do, because I thought about this first little bit before I started writing it and how it could segue into. Okay, never mind. You know Marty? No, not him. No, not him either. I'm talking about the 1955 Best Picture winning film Marty. It stars Ernest Borgnine as Marty and Betsy Blair as Claire, two people who are in their 30s or approaching it who can't find love. They accidentally meet one night and walk around New York talking until sometime in the AM.
I love it.
Mostly. Marty the movie let me down a little bit with a subplot about Marty's mother who's afraid of him moving out and her being alone. It's not a bad source of drama, but in this case it was contrived and annoying. It was a very Hollywood movie element in an otherwise accurate human story. Well, now meet Jesse and Celine. Jesse, played by Ethan Hawke, is on his way to Vienna to catch a cheap plane back to the States, and Celine, played by Julie Derpy, is a French student heading to Paris from Budapest before school starts back up. After the noise of a fighting older couple gets to her, Celine moves to a train seat next to Jesse. The 20-somethings almost immediately start talking. Both enjoying it, Jesse makes a proposal.
I want to keep talking to you. You know, I have no idea what your situation is, but I feel like we have some kind of connection, right?
Yeah, me too.
Yeah, right. Well, great. So listen, here's the deal. This is what we should do. You should get off the train with me here in Vienna and come check out the town.
What?
Come on, it'll be fun.
Come on. What would we do?
I don't know. All I know is I have to catch an Austrian Airlines flight tomorrow morning at 9:30, and I don't really have enough money for a hotel, so I was just going to walk around. And it'd be a lot more fun if you came with me. And if I turn out to be some kind of psycho, you know, you just get on the next train.
Let me get my bag.
The two spend the rest of the day and night walking around Vienna as they discuss life in general.
I don't think it really matters what generation you're born into. Look at my parents. They were these angry young May 68 people, revolting against everything. You know, the government, their conservative Catholic backgrounds. I mean, I was born not long after, and then my father went on to become the successful architect, and we began to travel all around the world while he built bridges and, you know, towers and stuff. I mean, I really can't complain about anything. You know, they love me more than anything in the world, and I've been raised with all the freedom they had fought for. And yet, for me now, it's another type of fight. We still have to deal with the same old shit, but we can't really know who or, you know, what the enemy is.
I don't know if there really is an enemy, you know? I mean, everybody's parents fucked them up. You know, rich kids' parents gave them too much, poor kids, not enough. You know, too much attention, not enough attention. They either left them, you know, they stuck around, taught them the wrong things.
Their lives specifically.
I remember my mother once, she told me right in front of my father, they were having this big fight, that he didn't really want to have me. You know, that he was really pissed off when he found out that she was pregnant with me. You know, that I was this big mistake. And I think that really shaped the way I think. I always saw the world as this place where I really wasn't meant to be.
That's so sad.
No, I mean, I eventually kind of took pride in it. You know, like my life was my own doing or something. You know, like I was crashing a big party.
that's the way to see it.
And romance.
You know, I've been wondering lately. Do you know anyone who's in a happy relationship?
Yeah, sure. You know, I know happy couples. But I think they lie to each other.
Yeah. People can live their life as a lie. My grandmother, she was married to this man, and I always thought she had a very simple, uncomplicated love life. But she just confessed to me that she spent her whole life dreaming about another man she was always in love with. She just accepted her fate. It's so sad. And in the same time, I love the idea that she had all those emotions and feelings I never thought she would have had.
They laugh, get in their first argument, kiss, and oh my god, I can't tell you how much I love this movie. It's so sweet and hopeful and magical. I'm a 30-year-old married dude with a 4-year-old, but this movie brought back the emotions of that enchanting time in your 20s when love can be so pure. And that's not to say I'm a jaded guy unhappy in his marriage, or that those emotions can't and don't happen in your 30s, 40s, etc., but it's different in your 20s. In your 20s, you're young, naive, smart, full of yourself, down on yourself. You think you know everything about life, but you actually know very little about it. You're cynical, you're hopeful, you're a world of possibilities, you're a world of hope. At least you can be. Jesse and Celine definitely are. Jesse is romantic, but also cynical about love and life.
I guarantee you it was better that way. If she'd ever got to know him, you know, I'm sure he would have disappointed her eventually.
How do you know? You don't know them.
Yeah, I know. It's just people have these romantic projections they put on everything, you know, that's not based in any kind of reality.
Romantic projections?
Yeah.
Oh, Mr. Romantic up there in the Ferris wheel, kiss me, the sunset. Oh, it's so beautiful.
All right.
Celine dreams of romance, but is also practical.
I always feel this pressure of being a strong and independent icon of womanhood and not making look like my whole life is revolving around some guy. But loving someone and being loved means so much to me. I always make fun of it and stuff. But isn't everything we're doing in life a way to be loved a little more?
Their time together is finite, but you can see the endless possibilities of their continued romance, even if you know it practically is unlikely to happen. But you still can't help rooting for them. Thanks to director and co-writer Richard Linklater and co-writer Kim Krizen, Jesse and Celine are never unintentionally pretentious, their conversations never dull or false, their situation never contrived. It's all perfectly true.
Like in this scene where Jesse pretends to talk to her friend on the phone about meeting Celine.
You know how they say we're all each other's demons and angels? Well, she was literally a Botticelli angel, just telling me that everything was gonna be okay. She didn't like me much at first. You know, she's super smart, very passionate, and beautiful. And I was so unsure of myself. I thought everything I said sounded so stupid.
Oh, man. I wouldn't worry about that.
No.
No, I'm sure she was not judging you. No, and by the way, she sat next to you, no? I'm sure she did it in purpose.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah. Us men are so stupid. We don't understand anything about women.
Mm-mm.
Because Linklater and Krizen capture that weird half-twilight, half-dream minutes or hours you spend talking to someone without a care in the world. Those moments when, as Jesse and Celine put it, time is yours. That time under starry twilight when everything is romantic and enchanting. And in that time, you form a perfect bond with someone through conversations that mean nothing and everything.
Sometimes I dream about being a good father and a good husband. And sometimes it feels really close. But then other times, it seems silly, like it would ruin my whole life. And it's not just a fear of commitment or that I'm incapable of caring or loving, because I can. It's just that if I'm totally honest with myself, I think I'd rather die knowing that I was really good at something. That I had excelled in some way. And then that I'd just been in a nice, caring relationship.
Yeah.
And the film so captures those nights many of us have had that you feel like you're the one on the date, and you don't want it to end either. But as the night goes on, and morning slowly but quickly comes, as the movie comes closer to its final minutes, you start counting the time along with Jesse and Celine. Knowing that magical moment is slipping away and you don't know when it'll return. For magic comes on its own schedule and can't be forced or created. I've never seen a movie bottle those experiences as well as this one. It's perfect. It's what Marty could have been. There aren't any distracting subplots. There aren't any actual supporting characters. It's just Jesse and Celine, and that's appropriate. Because in those magical moments, there isn't anyone but you and the other person. And keep in mind, I still love Marty. I think it's a great depiction of a special first date, and its leads are charismatic and filled with chemistry. So when I say Before Sunrise is better than it, that's saying something. I love Before Sunrise so much that I wanted to pop in its sequel, Before Sunset, almost right away. And as I wrote this review at almost 2 a.m. the night before I knew I was going to have to be in dad mode and watch an endlessly active child all day, I still wanted to pop it in. But instead, I'll save Before Sunset and its sequel, Before Midnight, for another day. For now, I'm left with a giddiness that I really needed. For one night, I was able to escape my troubles and make time my own. And in this era of uncertainty and fear and hate, what better medicine than a movie that reminds us to love and dream?
Don't look that good. Well, it just goes to show, though people say we're an unlikely couple, I'm seeing double of you.
Hey everyone, hope you enjoyed all that. Please let me know what you thought about the review and the movie in the comments below. If you liked the episode, please hit the like button, and if you're new to the channel, please subscribe. A link to my film blog can be found in the description below, and you can also find me on Twitter at CinemaPackRat.